We'll now turn to Landoff Road Barbergos, who will be talking about morphological experimental design of an eco-friendly modular shoreline protection system.
All right. Thank you for the introduction. Glad to see everyone here. Let's start by giving a little bit of context. So this is a synthetic version of the graph that we saw before. And earlier this morning, we saw different trends regarding hurricanes and major storms. What I want to highlight here is that the number of disasters has been increasing the last 40 years. And the other trend that I want to highlight is that if you see the components within this graph, you have tropical cyclones, severe storms, and flooding becoming more and more important. So we have more disasters, and they create more damages. This is something that if you project to coastal regions, means storm surge, means wave, means flooding. And this is something we know in South Florida. We live with that and the seasonal variation, I would say. And if you map actually the disasters, so if you go in the synthetic version of the graphs that were shown earlier today, you can see that basically Southeast United States is the region which is more prone to such disasters. So what is our goal? Well, our goal is simple, and you can find it everywhere. We want to make our coastal communities less prone to weather and climate disasters. So we don't need to see those effects, such as the Hurricane Irma, the picture from the Hurricane Irma, the photo that you see on the left, or the effect of the Hurricane Michael in the transportation network that you see on the right. But we want to do it in a different way, in a smart way. We have to do it by thinking also about sustainability, about the environment. So we have to preserve and enhance the natural environment in some ways. So now, if you're talking about coastal protection, you have two major strategies. So you can be on the good guys or the bad guys. You can be a nature-based or a green solution supporter. So this requires, of course, natural ecosystems in place that, of course, protect the shore. This has been proved, and we've been working with this. But there are some disadvantages also with that. And you can be on the bad side, which is my side, actually, from the gray side. So you can use seawalls. You can use concrete and structures, massive sometimes, to protect your valuable infrastructure. Now, if we do an analysis of the pros and cons, we can argue about this in a philosophical matter, but there are some things that we cannot avoid. First of all, we can argue about the value of the ecosystems. It is great, and they do protect our shores. But one thing that we have to understand is that the natural ecosystems do not protect at the level that we want, especially for high energy tidal flows, basically when we have a lot of waves. They also require a large footprint. So you need a lot of volume and space. On the other hand, our structures, they are man-made structures. They cost a lot. They are often prone to collapse. So we haven't found the perfect structure yet. And of course, they come with some costs. So they are often expensive, not only from the perspective of material or installation, but also with respect to the general cost-benefit analysis. So you can see some numbers there. So what we are trying to do here is engineer a system that would be efficient, that would be cost-effective, that would work in terms of multiple locations for multiple conditions, including high-energy tidal flows, but on the same time provides a habitable space which is bio-friendly for the marine environment. So the answer for that is what we call SeaHive. It's a system of perforated tubular elements that are made out of biocompatible reinforced concrete. The idea behind and the development has been focusing on what we call structural morphology. So structural morphology comes from the theory of structural design. It's about how the relationship between a structure, its function, its form, the material, the forces that are applied. And if we actually form that and we put that we need to be biocompatible, we have to assess what is this compatibility with all those parameters with respect to the organisms that we expect to host. So this is because when you're designing such hybrid structures, you have to have solutions at different levels of design. You have to strike by the macro scale, but you also have to think about the material you're using. You have to think about the interface, which at this application is the surface between the ecosystem and your structure. So now some features of our SeaHive system. So the SeaHive is basically made out of hollow tubes These tubes are perforated. We started different configurations. So we start with a square configuration, and we went all the way to a circular. The square provides you a flat surface. It's a modular way of getting a flat surface. You can compare with existing seawall designs. The circular one is relating to the regular piles that we see often in coastal construction. The hexagon, though, comes from some morphological considerations. If you see the beehive, as an example, is actually constructed as hexagons because hexagon allows you to have the largest volume for the minimum material use. So this way, we can actually use the material in a more efficient way. Of course, we're talking about perforation, so we're talking about not only the void that we have, but how this void is attributed throughout the elements. We have an adaptive system, so a modular system. We can create different slopes. We can variate the density of our perforations. We can use it horizontally or vertically. And by considering also the construction and the fabrication, we believe that we can be cost effective because such elements are commonly used in other applications. So we can use traditional pipe making equipment. It's just about the perforations and how these can be installed. On the other hand, by using the right type of material, we can be environmental friendly. In this case, we use concrete made of seawater, so the exchange with the marine environment is minimized. And we use non-corrosive rebars, which is a big problem if you're talking about environmental issues with respect to reinforced concrete. And of course, we add the required structural complexity. Now, with respect to our design, we use the models that are available and the guidelines. But due to the complexity of our system, we went towards a very experimentally heavy approach. So we use the sustain. So sustain is the wind wave tank that is hosted here at Rasmus. I invite you to go and see it. It's a unique facility. It's a wind wave tank that can generate winds up to category 5. And on the same time, we can control mechanically the generated waves. So we can have an interaction between wave and wind, and we can generate our own hurricane conditions that we can test our designs in. So our design takes place into two phases. The first phase is about the form and the understanding what are going to be the loads. So we have different cross sections and different perforations profiles. So you can see our models there. The models are scaled down. We do a similarity study based on wave that we took from five different locations, so we have buoy data that we analyzed. And also, we are exploring all the experimental parameters in a dimensionless analysis so we can actually scale up later on. So what we saw, some things that we expected. So we saw that we have differences in the pressure that is applied on the elements, and of course, we have differences in the water level that is recorded inside and after the elements. This, however, can be attributed into differences in the flow, as well as differences in the perforations. But if you compare just with respect to the square elements, you can see that perforations do reduce the pressure, and this is basically by reducing the reflection that we get from the wall. And reflection is a big thing, because it typically that's what causes scour and other effects there. Now, in the phase two, we're focusing on the system design. So we're currently experimenting. We're building this seawall section that we're going to test. We're going to instrument it with various sensors so that we can value also the load, but as well as the performance. Now, in parallel, we've been conducting some auxiliary studies that focus on biocompatibility. We focus on the development of the material, so we're looking for a biofilling concrete. So we have some concrete tiles that have been exposed now for 3 months in the marine environment, and we collect them every now and then, and we do an analysis about them. Number of microorganisms that have been populating these tiles. Now, laboratory tests and testing the tiles is very important, but you must complement that with actual field data. And luckily, we have some community partners, such as North Bay Village, which help us identify potential sites where we can use the system in an experimental prototype setting, where we can actually do some real testing and gather the data that we need, not only on the performance of the system, but also about the biocompatibility. There, we're working with our colleagues, and we will deploy actually some trays of seagrass that is going to be inside those elements and that we're going to monitor the growth and mortality throughout the system. So that's the only way you can actually say that you're developing a system that is going to be both efficient and biocompatible. Lastly, I want to thank all the actors that interfere in this research. As you understand, this is a research that is heavily multidimensional and multidisciplinary, so I have to thank everybody on this team as well as our funding sponsors. Thank you.
Have time for a question or two.
Of low perforation, no perforation low and high, and at the higher elevations in the high perforation, you actually had an increase in pressure.
It might be due, so this is just an instance from a test. We can review it afterwards, but I have to say that the pressure that we see, the maximum, these are maximum envelopes that we observe throughout our test. The maximum occurs basically there where the water is, so we expected to see it, but you might see some effects depending on the conditions based on the perforation. So we see some fluctuations depending on the configuration. It's not so easy to understand because the flow change, the flow field changes, and also it depends on where exactly the perforation is, if it's a small one or a bigger one. So it's not, we're a little bit going through a statistical analysis on this, trying to understand how we can better capture this.
Okay, cool, thanks.
Thank you.
Great, thank you.